Praise the Lord, everybody. We are doing Mary, Burial, and Baptism YouTube number 4. God bless you. Would you pray with me? Father God, in Jesus' name. O earth, 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 hear the word of the Lord. The Bible says, Lord God, we thank you that you're the God of all flesh and that nothing is too hard for you, O God, and we thank you for it. In the name of Jesus, Lord, we thank you for the integrity and power of your word. And we thank you, O God, that you're in full control and that you work with all things after the counsel of your own will. And we thank you for another marriage, burial, and baptism class, O God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Praise the Lord. I've taught you before that the Hebrew word bereith means a compact. Because of the passing between two pieces of flesh in Genesis 15. If you remember, I taught you that God put Abraham to sleep. And Abraham had killed the animals and he cut them. When they would make these sacrifices, you all, they cut the animal right down the backbone. Okay? And the two covenant members had to walk between the two pieces of dead flesh, and they would pronounce blessings and cursings as they walked in a figure eight between the halves of the animal. Amen? And this whole thing gives the thought of cutting a covenant, cutting a covenantal agreement. It's a covenant is a solemn binding agreement or promise, usually between two parties, especially for performance of some sort. Okay? Performance of some action. The verb form of this word, bereith, means to promise by covenant or to pledge. A divine covenant is introduced by God and God only. Man in and of himself is powerless to initiate a divine covenant because he doesn't have the power. The covenant between God and man had to originate with God. Amen? God alone has the mind, the authority, and the ability to make the covenant effective. It has always been God's heart and nature that motivated him to initiate covenants with man. That's so good. The covenants are a great manifestation of God's love, God's grace, and God's mercy. The Bible reveals that God is a covenant-keeping God, a covenant-revealing God, and a covenant-keeping God. So he's a covenant-making, a covenant-keeping, and a covenant-revealing God. The Bible itself is a covenantal book. The Old and New Testament, the Greek word for covenant is diatheke, which I'm going to teach in a little bit, but another word for that word for covenant in the Greek diatheke is testament, and we're going to show that. So the Bible is a covenantal book. Because the two testaments are really saying two covenants. Hallelujah. I'm going to do a little contrast between a contract and a covenant. A covenant is a solemn binding agreement between two or more parties with God as a witness. Within a covenant, you have a greater. You have a greater and a lesser. Within the covenant, the greater party offers the covenant and protects the lesser. So in the covenant with God, God is the greater and he protects the lesser. Hallelujah. Covenant fulfills its promise to the lesser party as the greater one is making sure that that happens. A covenant is established only by the shedding of blood. Differences between a covenant and a contract. A covenant, God is witness. God is, does not have to be witness in a contract. A contract has a legal obligation, which is not always so with a covenant. The covenant also has a lesser party, which is not necessarily true of a contract. A contract involves a pledge. Hallelujah. And as I mentioned, a contract doesn't have blood in it, and a contract has no relationship. For example, if you buy a couch from a store or from someone else, you do the transaction, you pay it, and you get your merchandise. But you don't have to have any relationship with the person that you're buying the couch from. You don't have to love them. You don't have to have anything else to do with them ever again. Hallelujah. So with a contract, there does not have to be a relationship. But obviously, in a covenant, you got to have a strong relationship. Hallelujah. As I mentioned, the covenant between God and man had to originate with God. And I mentioned that we see that God is a covenant-making, covenant-keeping, and covenant-revealing God. A contract is an exchange for two or more parties to fulfill a legal obligation. It involves a pledge or consideration that is of value. There is no blood needed in a contract. The general purpose for a covenant is to provide a binding sense of commitment to an interpersonal relationship. That's one of the most important differences between a contract and a covenant, is that in covenant, you have to have interpersonal relationship. You must be in relationship with your covenant partner in the covenant. The specific purpose of a divine covenant is for the covenant to be the vehicle of the expression of God's will and purpose for man. Covenants are also to be to show God's will and purpose towards man. Covenants are also to be effective means by which God's will and purpose is fulfilled. The root word to bereath is barah, B-A-R-A-H, almost like barah, which means to make something out of nothing. It's in the same family of words, which means to select. So that's the root word for bereath. So in a covenant, you select your partner and your partner selects you. Are y'all with me? Now the root word to barah, which means select, is interesting. It's the Hebrew word bar, which means grain. That's what I'm going to say. Well, Tim, what does grain have to do with a covenant? This is so good. Because grain was used to fatten up the animal that would be killed for the sacrifice. That's why it's a root word to bereath or covenant. So the root word to barah is bar, which means grain. And the reason why that's involved in this whole covenantal discussion is because grain is used to fatten up the animal, to kill the animal for the sacrifice. Hallelujah. The Greek word for covenant is diatheke, D-I-A-T-H-E-K-E. The root word to diatheke is diatathemai. Now, diatheke means a disposition, an arrangement, a testament, or a will. The root word to diatheke, diatathemai, means to put apart, to dispose by assignment, compact, or bequest, to appoint, to make a testator. The Bible tells us that you can't have a testament, which is one of the definitions of for diatheke unless you have the death of the testator. Hallelujah. So this word, diatathemai, is a combination word in the Greek. Dia means through. And tathemai means to place. So the root word to this word for diatheke means to place through. So in the covenant relationship, you're placing a relationship through the blood and the love that you have for the other member of the covenant. As I mentioned, diatheke can also mean covenant. I mean, besides covenant, can also mean testament. And in order for you to have a testament, somebody has to die. I want to read you Hebrews 7:22. This is in the KJV. Hebrews 7:22, KJV. Give me a second. This is KJV, Hebrews 7:22. Hebrews 7:22, by so much was Jesus made a surety of a better testament. That word testament is diatheke. As I mentioned, diatheke means can mean covenant, but it can also mean testament. It can also mean will. We are in the new will, in the new covenant, in the New Testament of the Bible. Amen. Let's go to Luke 1:72. In Hebrews 7:22, that word diatheke, when we looked it up, we saw that that meant testament. Let's go to Luke 1:72. Luke 1:72, right in the first chapter. First chapter of Luke is a long chapter if you look at it. Luke 1:72, and it reads thusly. To perform the mercy promised to our fathers and to remember his holy covenant. That word covenant is diatheke. Amen. And so I just want to show you some New Testament scriptures that have diatheke in it. Okay. In every case in scripture, when a covenant was instituted or initiated between God and man, God is seen as the initiator. It is God that initiates covenant, not man. Man did not come to God with a proposal seeking God's approval. Rather, God came to man declaring his will and seeking man's obedience. Isn't that good? A covenant is an agreement between God and man, drawn up by God and presented to man. Man can either accept the covenant or reject it, but he cannot change it. Kokoro shoba. Isn't that good? We see in covenants, we have mentioned a lesser one. Hallelujah. And I didn't know about that till recently. I will give you another example of a lesser and a greater. Let's go to Hebrews 6:13. Hebrews 6:13. I don't know about y'all, but I'm having a good time teaching y'all this. Hebrews 6:13. For when God made promise to Abraham, because he could swear by no greater, he swear by himself. This is so good. The promise, and with God swearing and everything, what this is talking about is the fact that eventually Abraham is going to have a son from his own loins, from his own loins. Okay? The promise to Abraham was concerning the birth of Isaac. Now here, what I'm going to teach you in Hebrews 6, this is not a covenant that we see here, but an oath. And there's no blood here. During these Bible times, one man had to swear by the greater. So God couldn't find anybody greater than himself, so he swore by himself. Hallelujah. If God had put out an all-points bulletin throughout the universe, he could have never found anyone greater than himself because he's the greatest. So where it says that he swore, that means he took an oath. So when it says here in Hebrews 6 that God swore, that means that he took an oath. The reason that the eternal God confirmed what he told Abraham with an oath is because it was going to be 25 years from that time in Genesis 12 before the fulfillment of Isaac, the son of promise, was born. Hallelujah. Let's go to Genesis 12, 1 through 4. Genesis 12, 1 through 4. Hallelujah. I feel my teacher coming. Hallelujah. Genesis 12, 1 through 4. Now the Lord had said unto Abram, get thee out of thy country, and from thy kindred, and from thy father's house, unto a land that I will show you. I love this. Instead of people would ask me, Abram, where you going? I don't know. Where are we going to forge your mail? I don't know. He said he was sending Abram to a land that he would show him. So Abe didn't know where he was going. 12 and 2, Genesis. And I will make of thee a great nation, and I will bless thee and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. Now, Abe was childless. He was old. His wife was old and barren. So this whole concept of them having a child through Abe's own loins, that looked all but impossible. 12 and 3, Genesis. And I will bless them that bless thee, and curse them that curse thee, and in thee shall all families of the earth be blessed. Hallelujah. So, when he said that Abe's going to have all these children, it's going to come, Isaac's going to be the first one. Is everybody with me? Hallelujah. So, go back to Hebrews 6. Hallelujah. So in Hebrews 6 and 13, it says, for when God made promise to Abraham, because he could swear by no greater, he swear by himself, because he was the greatest. So, the reason why the eternal God took an oath and confirmed what he told Abraham with an oath is because it was going to be 25 years, and he didn't want Abe to get shaky before Isaac showed up. The fulfillment of Isaac being born. Hallelujah. Let's read 6, 14 and 15. Hebrews 14, saying, surely blessing I will bless thee, and multiplying I will multiply thee. And so, after he had patiently endured, he obtained the promise of Abraham, a son through his own loins. Are y'all with me? Hallelujah. Now in 14, where it says, surely blessing I will bless thee, and multiplying I will multiply thee. This figure of speech is called a polyptoton, polyptoton, a polyptoton. This is a figure of speech used for special emphasis. Literally, God was saying, when he said that, and bless God, bless thee, etc., he's saying, I will surely bless thee, or I will richly bless thee. Hallelujah. The Hebrews were going through great trials at the writing of the book of Hebrews. So this phraseology is important so that the Hebrews would be assured that God would do just what he said he was going to do. Hallelujah. As Abe waited 25 years for the son of promise, Isaac, to come out of his own loins. Glory to God. Drop down to 16. For men verily swear by the greater, and an oath for confirmation is to them an end of all strife. When people made a solemn commitment during those times, they guaranteed the promise by an appeal to a greater one than themselves. This is so good. Swear here in Hebrews 6:16 means to threaten with an oath or to declare. The word greater that we see in the 16th verse is mizon, M-E-I-Z-O-N, and it means larger, elder, stronger. That's what greater means. And the word oath that you see in Hebrews 6:16 is horkos, H-O-R-K-O-S in Greek, and it means, this is so good, a fence, a limit, a restraint. So your oath fences you in to do what you promise. Your oath limits you to do what you promise. Your oath restrains you to do what you promise. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. Now, what I love is the greater one was brought into this because the greater one's, and now that the greater one's name has been brought into this, this changed the whole complexion of everything. Because the greater one, now his name is put into this oath that you made. The greater one, this is so good, listen. The greater one would punish you. He might get a stick and beat you if you did not keep your word because you swore by the greater one. And that greater one is watching to make sure that you do what you promise, because that's going to make him look bad if you don't. And he will punish you. The greater one will punish you. This is so good. So the greater one was watching to make sure that you did what you said you were going to do, because now his name is on the line. And he's going to punish you if you lied and you didn't do what you said. So when you bring in the greater one who's going to beat you and punish you if you don't do what you said you're going to do, that kind of settle the whole matter. People aren't going to worry about it anymore. I'm going to read 6:16 again. For men verily swear by the greater, and an oath for confirmation is to them an end of all strife. So this is the most strong form of assertion that existed during Bible times. And it had two results. One, it confirms what had been said. And two, it ends all argument. Because here in 16, when it says an oath for confirmation, that word confirmation points to the force of a legal guarantee. That word confirmation means guarantee, a legal term, a legal guarantee. So, it ends all argument, because that word confirmation, as I mentioned in the KJV, has the fourth force of a legal guarantee. Hallelujah. Now I'm going to read what I just read you in the KJV to you in the Voice Bible. Hallelujah. So I'm going to run to the Voice. And I'm reading you from the Voice via Bible from Hebrews 6, 13 through 16. Hebrews 6, 13 through 16. This is good. Starting at 6:13. Remember when God made his promise to Abraham? He had to swear by himself, there being no one greater. 14. Surely I will bless you and multiply your descendants. 15. After Abraham had endured with patience, he obtained the promise that he hoped for, and that promise was the birth of his son Isaac. When swearing an oath to confirm what they are saying, humans swear by someone greater than themselves, and so brings their arguments to an end. It ends all strife and all argument, because now you know the person's got to do what they said, because you don't want the big greater one to show up and start whooping on you. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. So that kind of ends all strife and kind of makes it all good. And that way the other person knows that you're going to do what you said you were going to do. Hallelujah. Some of the covenants that we're going to talk about next time, in Genesis 6:18, we see a covenant with Noah. In Genesis 5:18, we see a covenant with Abraham. And in Genesis 17:2, we see a covenant with Abraham. In 2 Samuel 23:5, we see the Davidic covenant, or a covenant with David. And God had promised to make a new covenant with the house of Israel in Jeremiah 31 through 34. And then you see the everlasting covenant mentioned in Isaiah 55:3. God keeps his covenant. He does not forget. He always followed through on his commitments that he has made. You can read Deuteronomy 7:9 and 2 Chronicles 6:14. I'm going to go over these scriptures next time. In Romans 1:31, you will see the term covenant breaker. That's the Greek word asynthetos. A, I've told you before, means not. It's the alpha negative. And the word synthetemai means to place, to consent, to agree. So, that word means not placed, not in agreement. Okay? So that's asyntheteos. And that's where we get our word covenant breaker from. God must reveal the covenant to man openly, declaring the promises and terms apart from God. And as I mentioned, God takes the initiating and the revealing of his covenants to man. Man would be ignorant of the availability of a relationship with God if God hadn't explained it to him. Let's go to Ecclesiastes 4:9. Hallelujah. Ecclesiastes 4:9. A little bit behind Isaiah. Ecclesiastes 4:9. Ecclesiastes 4:9. Two are better than one, because they have a good reward for their labor. Underline better. That word better, the root word of that word better in the Hebrew is tob, T-O-B. And that root word means to make or to be. This is so good. The root word here means to make or to be. It said two are better, or two are making or to being than one. God dropped this in my spirit. I love this. So what God is really pointing to is children and your relationship. Two are better, or two are doing to be or to make. To be or to make children. Come on. I love it. So that's why two are, that word better means to be or to make. Two are to be and to make than one. Because you can't make by yourself. You got to have your wife or your husband, your spouse, to make. To get into the to be realm, you got to have your wife or your husband. Hallelujah. Let's go to Malachi 2:14 through 16. This is good. I'm loving this. Malachi 2:14 through 16. This is good. You know, I think I'm gonna read this in the New Living Translation. They made it so much more easily understood. So I'm gonna go to the New Living Translation, and we're gonna read Malachi 2:14 through 16. Malachi 2:14 through 16. No, let's start at 2:13. Here's another thing you do. You cover the Lord's altar with tears, weeping and groaning because he pays no attention to your offerings and doesn't accept them with pleasure. Oh, this is good. You cry out, why doesn't the Lord accept my worship? I'll tell you why. Because the Lord witnessed the vows you and your wife made when you were young. God was watching. But you have been unfaithful to her, though she remained your faithful partner, the wife of your marriage vows. So the husband is acting up, and guess what? God saw it. I love this. So when the man acts up, biblically we see that God's watching, and he makes it so God doesn't accept your worship and stuff ain't working. Why? Because you've forsaken the wife of your youth. This is good. 2:15, did the Lord make you one with your wife? In body and spirit, you are his. What does he want? Godly children from your union. The KJV says that he wants a godly seed. So we see one of the main things that God wants from the marriage is a godly seed. So guard your heart, remain loyal to the wife of your youth because you're supposed to get the godly seed as you interact with your wife. Malachi 2:16. For I hate divorce, says the Lord, the God of Israel. To divorce your wife is to overwhelm her with cruelty, says the Lord of heaven's armies. So guard your heart. Do not be unfaithful to your wife. Isn't this good? Hallelujah. So what we're seeing here is God's watching. God's watching the whole time. I'm loving it. Now, I have mentioned before that you have to have three things to make a covenant. I mentioned before that you have to have three things to make a covenant. You have to have the blood of the covenant. You have to have the words of the covenant. And you have to have the token or the symbol of the covenant. In marriage, the blood of the covenant is when the hymen is supposedly broken during the first intercourse of marriage. I told you all before last time that they took a sheet, they call it the tokens of virginity, put it under the husband and wife as they're about to have supposedly their first sexual act. And the wife is supposed to be a virgin. And so the husband breaks the hymen and there's blood on the sheet. And that proves that his wife was a virgin in case he tries to come back with some crazy stuff later. Are y'all with me? So, and they call that the tokens of virginity. And I taught last time that if he's come and says that she wasn't a virgin, mommy and daddy kept those tokens of virginity. And they went to the elders at the gate with it, spread it out. Hallelujah. And then the elders beat the lying husband. The husband had to pay the father of the wife 100 shekels of silver. And thirdly, he could not divorce her for any reason ever for the rest of his life. Hallelujah. I love it. So, in a covenant, You have to have blood, you have to have a token of the covenant, and you have to have words of the covenant. As we talk about the marriage, the blood of the covenant is supposedly from the hymen being broken during the first intercourse. The words of the covenant are the wedding vows. So the wedding vows are the words of the covenant. The breaking of the hymen is the blood of the covenant. And the wedding ring is the symbol of the covenant. Without beginning and without end is the symbol of the covenant. Oh, hallelujah. So next time we'll get a little bit more into some other things concerning the marriage. But I wanted to make sure that we got the fact that you have to have three things to make the marriage. The blood of the covenant, words of the covenant, and the symbol of the covenant. Hallelujah. Now, we're going to talk next time about some of the covenants that God has cut. We have the Edenic covenant, the Adamic covenant with Adam, the Noahic covenant with Noah, the Abrahamic covenant in Genesis 15 that we already talked about. You got the Mosaic covenant, you got the Palestinian covenant, you've got the Davidic covenant, and you've got the New covenant. And we'll talk about those a little bit more next time. We're going to go to Genesis 14. Hallelujah. I love this. I'm enjoying this probably more than y'all are. Genesis 14. And 13. Now remember, in Genesis 14, we see the kings fighting each other. And the kings that were going against Sodom took Lot and his family. And Abe went to get him back, obviously. Genesis 14, 13. And there came one that had escaped and told Abram, the Hebrew, first time we see the Hebrew, for he dwelt in the plain of Mamre, the Amorite, brother of Eshcol, the brother of Aner, and these were confederate with Abram. I taught before that that meant that they were in covenant, but I want to break down these two words, because there's two words there for confederate. So Abram was in covenant with the Amorite, Eshcol, and Aner. And as a matter of fact, these Amorites helped Abraham fight to bring Lot back. Why? Because they were in covenant with Abraham. And that's why in Genesis 15, he could believe that he was going to have a miraculous son with an old barren wife. But he had a problem believing that God was going to give him a land, because the land he was going to give him belonged to the Amorites. And he knew that he was in what? In covenant with the Amorites. So when it says that these Amorites and Eshcol and Aner were confederate with Abraham. So this word, the first word is Baal here, and the last word is Berith again, Berith. That means covenant. And let's look at Baal. Baal means a husband, an owner, or master. So this word here, master, owner, husband, or owner, that's the first part, that's Baal, and the second part is Berith. So that's a master or owner covenant. That's a master covenant. Baal can mean master, husband, or owner. So this is a real powerful covenant. It's two words. It's Baal Berith, and this is what God, the type of covenant that God had entered into with Abram. Oh, hallelujah. Another thing that a covenant has to have is a time frame, unless it's an everlasting covenant. And what happened here, and I'm getting ready to close, hallelujah, is that Abraham was a little skeptical because he knew he had a covenant with the Amorites and with Anel and Asher and all that. So he said, he's like, so how am I going to get this land of the Amorites when I'm in covenant with the Amorites? One of the things that most covenants have is a time frame. And sometimes it'll take a long time for them to hash out how long this covenant is going to last. In this particular case, it was 430 years. Of course, Abe wasn't alive to see them get the land, but they got the land. God gave them the land because the Baal Berith, the master husband covenant that Abram had with them, was now over. And so Abraham sees his children, however many, they got the land, but it was just like God promised. As I touch you all the other time, it's impossible for God to lie, because whatever he says has to come into existence. Hallelujah. Father God, in the name of Jesus, Lord God, we praise you and we thank you. Oh, one other thing that I wanted to remind you all of, very important. We talked about the exchanging of the weapons belt and all that and cutting the palm. Another thing that they did when they cut a covenant, each person wore a coat or a mantle that represented their particular family. Once you cut covenant with someone else, you exchanged mantles, you exchanged coats, because that coat was representative of you and your family, and now you've exchanged it with your covenant partner. What that means, hallelujah, is that now, since you've changed coats, that means that all that you have and all that you represent now is contingent on what's going on with your covenant partner. So you've changed coats, so you've changed your identity. You now have his identity, and he now has your identity. Are y'all getting this? Oh, hallelujah. And what you've done, what you're basically saying there is, I am just like you, and you are just like me. And if anybody attacks you, I'm going to fight for you just like I fight for myself, because you've exchanged mantles or coats. Kabo-boshanda. Hallelujah. That's another thing that's done in the covenant. And what's beautiful about this is when Elijah went up, he dropped his mantle or his coat. And what did Elijah do? He picked it up. That showed covenant. They didn't have time enough to have blood because God came and got Elijah, took him up in a fiery chariot. Didn't have time to shed blood. But the exchange, well, it wasn't really an exchange because Elijah didn't need a coat where he was going. But now Elijah has Elijah's coat, which is showing covenantal relationship. Oh, hallelujah. And maybe that's why Elijah got the double portion, because now all that Elijah had was now part of what Elisha had, because the mantle now belonged to Elijah, showing covenantal relationship. Father God, in Jesus' name, we thank you, Lord, as you reveal more and more about your covenant via your word. We thank you, Lord, that your covenants all have a time frame on them, except the everlasting covenant. So, Lord God, we thank you for the power of the covenant. We thank you that all covenants are secured with blood. Shakarabobosha. Father God, we thank you and praise you and give your name the glory. Oh God. And we thank you that the blood covenant, the blood added to the covenant, is what gives it its power. And only God can initiate the covenant. Only God can give the power to the covenant. Lord, we give your name the glory, the honor, and the praise. In Jesus' name we pray. I'd like to throw the net out there. Anyone that has not received Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, please repeat after me. Say, Lord, I'm a sinner. I'm sorry. I believe that Jesus Christ died and raised again for my sin. And I received Jesus' shed blood into my life. Thank you, Lord, for saving me. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Become a member of a Holy Ghost-filled Bible-believing, Bible-teaching church. Even though most churches are just having church on Zoom, find someone that you feel comfortable with. Get on Zoom and listen to the church services, and we'll be back in church eventually. And then you can go on to church. God bless you. Thank you for your time. We give your name the glory, Lord God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.